I was born in Detroit, and I moved to Vegas when I was like five-ish, and basically I grew up here, and then whenever I graduated high school, I joined the Marine Corps, and I worked on helicopters for a living, and that's where some of this stuff came from. I honestly was taking apart electronics since I was little. As soon as I figured out what a Phillips head screwdriver was for, I had to start tearing everything apart. So basically, whenever I realized that after I took something apart, if I reapplied it to a canvas, I got to play with that electronic for twice as long, that's when I started doing my art. So that's kind of where all of this came from. So you can kind of, this whole wall is in chronological order. So like this is the first piece and this is the last piece. So that was number one, that's number 60. And then they're all just kind of in order. So you can kind of see how simple they were when I first started and then where it went from there. This one right here is probably one of my favorites because this one's named Detector Notices Unicorn. So that's like one of my, that's my favorite name, but.
Talk about the names and where the names come from.
So the names come from, the names are all an anagram of Neoteric Deconstruction. So like all of the pieces of art are an electronic that I took apart and I rearranged in another way that I liked. So all of the names are anagrams of Neoteric Deconstruction, and they all have 22 characters. The only exception to this is this one, because that one's called Conscience Editor, and I really like that name, and I didn't really want to do anything else with the rest of the letters, so that's the only exception. But yeah, each piece is kind of like an odd story. Like this one right here was my roommate's camera that I thought was my camera when I took it apart. And so he got home from work, and he's like looking at my little baggie of stuff that I had taken apart. And I was like, oh, it's my camera. And he's like looking at it, and he's like, I think this is my camera. And I'm like, no, that was the camera that was on the entertainment center for like however many months. And he's like, I'm pretty sure this is my camera. This is my camera. Like, put it back together. And I'm like, I can't at this point, but I can tell everybody it was yours. So, yeah. But that was the story with that one. But also, a lot of my pieces have Bruce Lee hidden in them because I have an unhealthy infatuation with Bruce Lee. So like this piece right here, you can't really see it with all the pieces on it, but this one says Bruce Lee on it. If you look on the website, I have a lot of those pictures of where it actually says Bruce Lee. But yeah, the website's neotericdeconstruction.com. Thank you for asking. But yeah, that's all these.
And why Neoteric?
Because I like the word neoteric. The reason why I like that word is because it's weird. Nobody knows what it means. And when you look it up, it has a different meaning depending on where you look it up. And it basically comes from like being chic, being new, being trendy, like something that's modern. And it has like, it lends itself to so many different things. So that's the reason why I like that. And then of course, deconstruction is exactly what's going on here.
So close to neurotic.
Yes, exactly. It's very close to neurotic. That's why I like it. Yes, like, that's good.
Are you good at reconstruction?
Well, on some of the early pieces, I didn't have enough tools like for me to take them apart properly, so I would have to break some pieces every once in a while. But now I have like all the tools, so for the most part, I could like when I was taking apart one of the pieces over there, I was thinking like I could actually put this entire thing back together. So, yeah.
She's improved her skill level.
Yeah. Right. So, yeah, that's that.
How long did the piece take? Like your roommate's camera, how much time did you spend on that?
I don't generally like sit down and do a whole piece from beginning to end. What I'll do is I'll generally go and I'll paint a bunch of canvases and then I'll take apart like three or four electronics and I'll throw them all in a baggie. And then I'll kind of like look at my canvases after they're done drying and then look at, you know, the pieces that I have and figure out like, oh, I think that this one looked good on that or this one looked good on that. The only one that I ever sat down and I actually did from beginning to end was that red one, which I'll talk about in a bit. But yeah, all the other ones, it was kind of just like, you know, when I feel like I need to paint, I just paint a bunch of stuff. And then when I feel like I need to take things apart because I've had a bad day or somebody really pissed me off, like I'll take apart. Yeah, exactly. It's so cathartic. You should try it, seriously. Yes.
Does it make your day better? Does it ever like make your day worse to be taking apart things?
No, it's kind of like the only way I can really kind of describe it is like REM sleep. So it's like, I get to take something apart and I get to like digest the situation and really kind of like analyze what's going on. And I can't fix this, but I'm gonna take this apart and try and figure out what's going on with this instead, so. Yeah.
Like a meditation.
Yeah, exactly, meditation.
Yeah. It's like a Zen garden.
Wait, did you start?
I started like 4 years ago. So 4 years ago is when I started doing this. That one's from, 4 years ago. So. Yeah. Yeah, all the way up until this one. This one wasn't even made when I first brought all the pieces up. And basically, I wanted something to offset that piece so I could do this wall like this. So me and Amanda were looking at the canvases that I had, and then I knew that I had a Palm Pilot. So I went ahead and I made this one of the days after I started setting up the gallery. So I really like that. Like, I really like where this piece came from. It's really cool. So.
Do you have a donation tab on your website?
No, you can bring them to me though. Like, everybody likes to bring me stuff like at my store, and then like some people have dropped off stuff at the gallery. So yeah.
I'll trade phones for a t-shirt.
Yes. That's generally what happens. I trade t-shirts for whatever I'm given. So buybacks, they donate a lot of stuff to me. Like buybacks donated this, and they donated a couple different things, and I've done door decals for them. So yeah.
You want to talk about that piece?
Yeah. So this piece right here, this is one of my favorites. This is a red Xbox piece. It's called Reintroduce Coin Contest, because, you know, it's a video game. This one's really cool because this is one of my favorites because it doesn't have any canvas and it doesn't have any paint. It's all just electronic and safety wire and some red wire in there for accent. But yeah, that's the Xbox piece.
Is that how you usually put them together? I wondered if you like maybe soldered some pieces together.
I don't solder pieces together, but I solder to take things apart. So if it's like a complicated electronic, I generally will just cut the wires off. But if it's not a complicated electronic and it's more simple, then I'll sit there with the soldering iron and I'll actually take the time to take all of the pieces apart. That's a really good question. It's the first time anybody's asked me that. But yeah. Yeah, this one's not one of the ones I would have done any kind of soldering on, but this
That's
one's
cool to use wire though.
Yeah.
Useless as some kind of knot or something.
No, I just kind of like tie it together and try and just like screw everything together and tie it together. So, but yeah, that one's number 40.
Is it pretty sturdy?
This one is actually a lot sturdier than it looks. Like if you were to try and like move it, it kind of does stay in that form. So yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it's pretty tight.
I like your shake test. You want to talk about that?
Oh yeah, so everyone makes funny. So basically, after I complete a piece, every time I complete a piece, I pick it up and I have to shake the shit out of it to make sure that everything's gonna stay on there. So everything comes off, I just re-glue it on there and like I shake it again. But so every piece has to go through the shake test. So yeah. The anagrams? So the anagrams come from the author Dan Brown. He used a program called Anagram Genius whenever he was writing the Da Vinci Code. So when I found that out, I thought it was only appropriate because it's super weird. And I started using Anagram Genius to help me with a lot of the anagrams, which is crazy because there's hundreds of thousands of anagrams for this, but I just go through and I kind of pick the words that I like, the words that I think are appropriate for the piece, the words I think are appropriate for whoever gave me the piece, like whoever gave me whatever electronic it is, or however I was feeling at the time, whenever I made it, I decided to I have tried that, but they won't talk to anything. I made a whole t-shirt about it and everything, so, yeah.
Yeah. Should we keep going?
Yeah, keep going. This one is number 26, is Contentious Concert Ride. Does anybody know what it is? It is a car stereo. So it's a stock car stereo for a Hyundai Santa Fe. But
there's no different pieces put in. Let's call the circle.
All these are the gears and everything. This was actually the faceplate. Like if you looked at it from the other side, you'd be able to recognize what it is.
Just, I wouldn't think there's so many.
Yeah, well, it's a CD player, and it was also a tape deck. So the tape deck is where a lot of the old technology came from, like the gears and everything. Like a CD player generally just has the lasers and everything in it, but the tape deck is actually what had most of the gears.
Is there a huge difference between like old CD players and new ones that you notice?
Yes, yeah. Like I can show you this over here. Like the old stuff is super awesome, but yeah. The older the technology is, the more I like it, because you can actually see how things are working. Yeah. But
it's a lot simpler, it seems like that's pretty clusterfuck.
Right. Yeah.
So. And why is the piece, or why are the pieces hung away from the wall?
The reason why the pieces are hung away from the wall is because I want people to kind of like look at them from different perspectives. So like, I don't really mean necessarily for people to look at all of them like this. Like, I kind of want for them to kind of look at it and look at it from different places. I think it's also kind of interesting on some of them to see how it's hung in the back. And also, I really, really, really dig the shadow effect on whenever I hang stuff. I noticed that whenever I started first hanging stuff at my apartment and taking pictures of it, I really dug the way that the shadows looked on the wall behind it, and that kind of just added a different dimension to it, so. Yeah.
Yeah, I never noticed that. Like
the shadows?
Yeah, that you like wanted them away from the wall.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's really interesting.
Yeah.
Taking consideration like where the lights are, like all the shadows are on one's way, or does that matter?
Yeah, no, we went through and spent a lot of hours fixing light the lights to make the lights go exactly where we want them, so. Neurotic.
A very generous gallery. Okay. Yeah.
We had trips to the store for extra.
Yes. Yeah.
Well, the shadows are an important part of the pieces.
Yes, it is. I think it's important because it also like just reamplifies the fact that they're not just a canvas on a wall. Like, it's made up of different things. Like, there's some cool shadows that come out of it too. Like, there's a shadow over there. I'll show you guys when we get over there. But really like it. I like it. To the next one. So the next one is number 34, and this is Decent Interior Coconuts. Basically, this one is just a camera. What happened with the film on the outside of it is I understand that it's movie film and this is camera film, but I just really wanted a chance to be able to play with the film. The film that's wrapped around the canvas and then on the outside of it is actually a trailer to Independence Day. And I didn't know what it was when I bought it. I just bought it from a flea market. So when I was like going through the film trying to figure out what it was, the very first scene in it is the Iwo Jima Memorial, which is a super Marine Corps symbolic thing. And so I was like, oh my God, that's so cool. And I freaked out. But the next scene was the White House exploding, and that's when I figured out that it was Independence Day. that's what this is. So it's a camera and on this one too, if you look at it, there's a screwdriver on here that was broken. In some of my pieces, I was including the pieces that I broke while taking it apart. So that's the reason why there's a little screwdriver in there. So, but yeah.
Did that happen a lot?
Yeah. Actually, one of the pieces over there is a hot glue gun, the pink one. And that piece, like that hot glue gun is number 7 because I had killed a whole hot glue gun by the time I got to 7. So that's when I decided to invest in better hot glue guns. But yeah. Yes. Right, because a lot of the pieces, like a lot of the electronics are held together by like rivets or, you know, by like just fashioning them together one way or another. Or, you know, there's not a YouTube video for everything. Like, I could go on YouTube and look up how to take apart an Xbox, right? But I can't go on YouTube and look up about like how to take apart this really weird camera from, you know, 1997, so. Yeah. No, because that's so awkward. But, yeah. That's this one, and then, okay. This one's one of my favorites. This one's number 59. This is Encounter Idiot Concerts. This one I love. I actually got this record player from a house that was in my family for 4 generations. This record player was in the attic, like completely covered up with different stuff. The reason why I love this piece so much, I actually took off the back. I didn't like the back, so it's mounted on the back if you guys want to look at it later. But I took off the back and I opened it up and I was looking at this the other way, and it was the mechanical parts of it were just so awesome. I just sat there and stared at it forever because I thought it was amazing how everything was just put together kind of mechanically. If you look, there's no circuit boards, there's no anything. It's just basically motor and wires and like that's it. And the thing that I love the most about this is the fact that A, when I opened it up, there was hairs in there from the person who made it, and B, the grease that's on these pieces, you can look at it and see that there's fingerprints. So you can literally see the fingerprints of the person that made it, and I just think that's so groovy.
How old could they?
This record player, it was manufactured between 1967 and 1969.
Wow.
So, yeah, that's...
Fingerprint?
Well, basically, you can kind of look at them in the grease still. Like, there's, you can see the fingerprints here, and you can see the fingerprints here whenever you come and look at it later. I didn't want to mess it up. Like,
yeah.
I was so scared of messing it
up.
Right, so, yeah. I left them where they were, but I'm sure that throughout moving them and everything that they didn't exactly stay. I just thought it was cool that they were there to begin with. Right. So yeah, that's this one. I really like this one. This was in my house and completed for less than 24 hours before I had to bring it up to the gallery. So I was like, no. And I always come and look at this first whenever I come up here. So yeah. Also, I thought it was interesting that it was made in England because I didn't know that they used to make things. But that was another little fun part about it, so.
They made things without cyberspace.
Right. Used to make things way back in the day. But yeah.
You mentioned it wasn't in the house. Do you want to talk a little bit about the process? Like, where do you work? What are you doing while you work? You said it was after
right.
Every day.
So, like, after my job, I go home and I watch documentaries because I'm like, against everything. Everything. I'm like gangs and like, the gangs, prisons, like GMOs, the vanishing of the bees, any kind of civic revolution, anything. I just watch anything that I find on Netflix, I pretty much watch it. So yeah, Netflix Instant or Zia, old movies, Tupac documentaries. I'm really into those. There's a lot of those. Yeah, no, you gotta watch them, it's great. He's super philosophical. But yeah, so that's what I just go home and I watch documentaries and sometimes I listen to music, a marker player, not this one. and then, yeah, so that's what I do.
And we're in your kitchen, right?
Yeah, it's all basically in my kitchen. I've got this huge kitchen table that I've done most of my pieces on, yeah. And it's like, I've got just art stuff all over my house. It takes over my whole house, so, yeah. No, I've made two pieces since number 60, so I've got 61 and 62, and I love them both. It's just, yeah, it's been a busy week or a busy month, so yeah, I've just made two more since then, but.
Still pretty productive.
Yeah, thank you.
Why numbering your paint, your artwork? Why not just create instead of numbering them?
Because I like to know, personally, like, I would want to know if I went in, like, what pieces came before what pieces? Because yeah,
like the chronological.
Exactly. I would like to know. When I look at Andy Warhol stuff, I like to know what pieces he made before he met, you know, Basquiat. Or I always forget how to. Yeah. So like, I like to know what pieces he made before that and what pieces he made after that. Like, I like to know what pieces were made like during different eras, and this just kind of, I don't know. Plus, it helps me keep things straight. So.
Well, it's neat to see it in the order.
Well, they were put like where they were, like for the aesthetic value.
Yeah,
so basically, to balance it out and everything. Yeah, I would. Yeah, they were put together neoterically. Yeah. No. Okay. So that's the record player one, and then. This one's 42. This also came from that house. And it's kind of awesome because I have pictures of my great grandparents playing this radio with like my dad, like really little. And this one also doesn't really have circuit boards, but it has this whole transistor situation right here, which I think is groovy. This one was also just in reaction to everything that happened in Michigan, but it's really awesome to look at these pieces and see how, if you look at this and then you look at the iPod, that's what I think is interesting, is just how different technology is and how we do things, how we listen to music now compared to how we listened to music then, and yeah.
Have you ever made a piece of art like that, where it's like an old electronic right next to a newer one?
Yes, there's a piece over there and it's got two cameras on it, and I'll talk about it whenever we get over there, but yeah, that's one of the things I really like doing, is kind of like comparing them, so, but yeah.
This one has two canvases,
Yeah, this one was kind of odd because it's like I took apart all the pieces and I arranged them on my kitchen table a couple of different times, and it didn't really seem like it had as much personality as I wanted it to have. So that's part of the reason why, like, when I was playing with the canvases, I'm like, well, maybe I should just make it like an odd canvas so that way it would stand out appropriately.
It's like a butterfly on the wall.
Yeah.
Symmetrical.
Yeah.
Yeah, it actually has the most, like, design, I think. You know what I mean? It stands out a lot.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right. Yeah, and I like the antennas and everything too, so.
Yeah, the antenna, I didn't even notice.
Yeah.
I know, I just noticed that, and I didn't see it the Wednesday night. Oh my gosh, how did I miss it?
It's weird to me when you see the antenna, you think car, you don't think radio.
Right,
That's what's weird.
Right.
You don't think radio at all anymore.
Right. Yeah.
Antenna made it tricky. Well, trying to figure out the dimensions of each piece.
Right. Yeah, because it's like you're supposed to do height and width, and then I had to add the element of depth to my dimensions. But on top of that, like, the antenna makes it weird because it's like, yeah, I mean, it's technically as big as, like, say, almost as big as that piece, but it's really not when you look at it because the antenna is kind of a...
Can you move the antenna?
Yeah, every time I've had to move it, I've had to push it down and then, like, move it. Like, there's another piece over there, I have to push down the antenna to move it around, but.
So it's a movable piece.
Yes. Yes.
People might really like that.
Yes. Yeah. So if you have to fit it someplace specific, you can push down the antenna a little bit. So, yeah.
All right. Let's get to this big one.
Okay. So this big one. This one is number 50. It's coerced to strict innuendo. This laptop was his, my stepdad's.
I get a commission.
And he was really bummed out that his laptop was broken, and I was so excited because I really wanted to take apart a MacBook. I was really excited about this one. This canvas was originally intended for the other laptop piece that's over there. This canvas, whenever I actually first made it, the fire department got called because I was making it by adding black chalk to it. And so on my balcony, apparently that looked like smoke coming off the balcony, so the fire department got called. It was kind of awesome. But yeah, this one was a lot of fun. This is another piece that has Bruce Lee hidden in it. I went through and I etched Bruce Lee into that back mirror glass. Another favorite part I have is this one with the little apple right there, and you can kind of see the reflection. I was really excited to see this one with the lights because I wanted to see how the reflection would be. Also, the reflection with the yellow pieces that I put on there, that looked so groovy. So
that's one laptop?
Yeah, this is just one laptop. So this laptop, I hurt myself so many times trying to take this apart because all the pieces are riveted together and they're all sheet metal, and it hated me. So basically, like, taking it all apart, I bled more for this laptop than any other piece. Huh? Oh yeah, it's definitely well made. This was made about the same time that this other laptop was made over there. And if you look at it, the difference in, like, this has maybe a quarter to like a fifth of the pieces is that laptop over there, and that's a Sony Vaio. Like, this, you can clearly just, like, this, taking this apart and taking the iPod apart and taking apart this other iPhone just clearly, it's clearly just better craftsmanship when you look at Apple products. I mean, I didn't really appreciate it until I started taking this stuff apart, but No, I was like, somebody else has asked me that, so I was trying to look at it and see if I could actually see blood. I was trying to take it off, but I certainly, huh?
Blacklight? Yeah.
Oh, I don't know. That would be interesting, though. Yeah. Yeah. That's an interesting note for next time. But.
Weird question, but do you see a huge difference between like China and America and England and other places in terms of manufacturing? You know what I mean? That's probably weird.
It's not, like, I haven't really, the most difference I see is, like, between older products and newer products, and then between, honestly, Apple products and, like, comparing it to a similar product of, like, the same time. Yeah, like, that's really the distinction that I see. I don't know if, yeah.
Yeah, I didn't know if they, like, put it together all differently.
Yeah,
no. The typical question, the parts now are all made all over the world.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
I know, so they all use the same stuff.
Yeah. And then there's a Samsung, they go inside Apple.
What's that?
There's a Is it the Samsung label?
The Samsung label?
Is there
Samsung?
Oh, there's
yeah,
parts from
it.
Yeah, parts from
it. Oh, yeah. Because, they're he said, like, they're all made from different parts from other places. Yeah. So.
Your job's rolling over because
you're just, like, exposed. Yeah. That's funny. Okay. Yeah. But, yeah, so that's the MacBook piece.
So, one thing I think is so interesting about your work, Angie, is that these are, the record player, but this is something I have on my desk at work and I go home to and I sit in front of it, and it's such a different way of formulating something that we're so familiar with in our like everyday lives.
Right.
Do you, when you're on the computer at work or at home, do you respect that machine? Are you waiting for it to break?
Oh no, I'm waiting for things to break. Yeah, no, I hate technology. Technology hates me, so it's a mutual thing. And basically, I kind of do get excited whenever things break. So then, like with his laptop, so then I could like take it apart and I get to see what's inside of it. Whenever anything breaks at my store, I get kind of excited because I have an excuse to go take apart my plotter or take apart like my heat press and like look inside of it and see what's going on. But yeah, I mean, I used to go through probably an iPhone every 6 months because I would drop it and completely mistreat it, and I hated it and it hated me. Yeah, and then I took apart an iPhone for the first time, and I was looking at the components of it, and I'm just looking at it, and I'm like, it makes sense why this kind of breaks whenever I drop it now, because those pieces are really close together. I can see how they wouldn't get along with each other if they were touching each other in the wrong way. So, like, yeah, it's made me appreciate some of the other little electronics I have.
How do you pry open an iPhone?
There's actually a whole tutorial online, but Okay. Basically you have to have special tools, which I have. Yeah. And you have to take off like the glass case and everything for like the glass on top. Just like a little tool that you get to take it off and yeah.
You just like cut through it or
something. See, there's people that do that. Yeah, that's how I found out how to take it off, is by watching one of those videos. So. Yes. It's really actually easy.
I assume so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, do you want to go to the podium or keep running around?
So we'll do this one and we'll do that one. What do you think? Okay. This one is number 13. It's one of my super early. It's probably the earliest piece that's on all of these walls. But it counted neurotic snore because it was an alarm clock. And this is the first one where I played around with not just putting the pieces on the canvas. I had it hanging down and I was kind of playing around with that whole thing. But yeah, this one's another one where, I mean, there's kind of circuit boards in there, but there's a lot of like micro switches, and you can actually see when you take it apart and you're looking at it, how exactly, you know, this piece connected to that piece and all that. There's still levers that you could see that this connected to that and turned off this speaker, you know. So that one was fun. But,
how do you decide on the canvas for each piece? Do you ever like go out of your way to make the canvas really interesting, you know?
Yeah, I mean, like,
hidden also, probably.
Yeah, I honestly, on some of them where the canvas doesn't turn out exactly how I want it, or where the canvas is a little muted, I'll put a little bit more of a vibrant electronic on there.
Yeah.
I also try and break up the monotony of like each electronic with a different paint that's behind it. So say, for instance, if I just had a whole bunch of canvases that were black and it had electronics on it, I don't think that would benefit the same way that having the different paint on it has. Does that make sense? Like, basically, like, I think it's kind of like, you know how when you go to smell perfume at a perfume counter and they give you coffee beans to like kind of like clear out, you know, whatever you're, yeah, so that's why I kind of see my painting as, I mean, I haven't, obviously, you know, it's not the focal point of it, but I think that kind of offsets it. Yeah, each one distinguishes each one from
dynamic added.
Right. Yeah, and then there's certain canvases, like there's a pink one over there on that salon wall that I really liked and I almost didn't want to cover it up, but yeah I really like the paint on that.
Some of them have like two or three like canvas on the fence, or I don't even know if that's a canvas, but you know, it's like three-dimensional, just having two there.
Yeah, there's actually three, but I'll talk about one.
Do you use every piece of the electronic in the artwork?
Yes, every piece gets used in it. I'm really big on, I really want for all of the pieces to be on there. Like I said, there's certain pieces where I don't necessarily like the way it looks. I don't think it adds to it at all. Like there's a piece for the record player that which you can see on the back. This Walkman down here, or Watchman down here, there's a bag that I actually got with it that I didn't like, and that's on the back. But yeah, I try and put like all of the pieces on there because I think that's important. I mean, you're trying to just look at it as expanded, taken apart and everything. Yeah, he has the hard drive. Yeah, that's an interchangeable part though, so. Yeah, yes. Yeah. Right. So, then this one, I'll do this one and then that one. So this one's number 52, it's torn on tedious eccentric. This one is a tape player and tape recorder. This one was actually a lot of fun for me to take apart because I hadn't taken apart like a tape recorder. I couldn't really distinguish the pieces on that one over there with the tape player. But this one, it was also a tape recorder. So when I took it apart, I actually spent a lot of time videotaping with my phone, like how the buttons work. So I'm just sitting there playing with the buttons and hitting record with the battery still in it and everything. So I could kind of see how it operated. And I thought it was really, really groovy. I wrapped this whole thing. This also had Bruce Lee hidden in it. You can't really see it now. But I wrapped the whole thing with the tape. It took me a really long time. And I actually hated it. And so I was about to cut it off. But Amanda came over and she said she liked it. So I left it. And apparently a lot of people like it. So, but yeah, I kind of dig it now too.
It's like electronic bondage.
Yeah. Well, that's what it is. It's kind of like electronic porn. Like I'm exposing... you know, all of their unmentionables. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, I love the layers. I think all of your work, it like forces you to spend time with it to figure out what it is and to see how much many pieces. Yeah, to almost deconstruct your deconstruction.
Yes.
But that one especially, like, we just have to dive.
You gotta look at it, yeah.
Does your artwork, like if somebody were to purchase it online and you shipped it to them, does it come with a description?
Well, all of the stuff that I'm telling you guys is pretty much all on the website. Like that's where I kind of like really sat down and started like, I added all the pictures because I have a lot of work in progress pictures. Hopefully if you see this and you wanted to buy something, you're gonna go through Amanda because that's the reason why you guys know about it. But basically, yeah, like all of the in process pictures and all of the little anecdotes and dumb things I have to say about my art, they're all on like the website. So you can check it out that way.
Yeah, I love all the titles because they're like, oh.
That's funny.
I'm torn on tedious eccentric. You know, it's like tedious.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah.
It's all kind of negative. So
I like it.
Well, yeah. In our five shows we've had here, we've never put titles on the wall, but Angie thought it was really important, and I agree that the titles are part of the piece.
It's a I mean, it adds a whole new thing to it.
Mm-hmm. I kind of pointed out,
I've
never seen this again before.
That's what I asked. No. So did you make all the decals?
Yes. Okay. Well, way to get my store involved, but yeah. So this one right here, this one's number 30. It's erotic nut and censored cut. This one was the first one where I really played around with putting the pieces like this. I really like the way that it turned out. I had friends pick out the colors of the paint and I had another friend give me the camera and it was all people that were from my high school. So we used high school colors and it's super cheesy. But I really like the way this one turned out. This is one of the ones that I'll stare at when I've got it, you know, and I'm just kind of like looking at it. But it's also one of the ones where I really heavily concentrated on putting the pieces on the sides. So, yeah. It's the first time I also even considered laying it flat instead of hanging it on the wall. The only thing is that the wood in the back of it is less than an inch, so it's kind of hard for me to find things that I can like mount, because usually things that you mount that are away from the wall, they're at least an inch of a hook or an inch of like a little L bracket, so you have to kind of like put it in there sideways and then force it to go straight, but yeah, you can hang this on the wall too. So.
And the other pieces can also be put flat.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Very
versatile. Yes.
What high school is?
Advanced Technologies Academy.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a magnet school that deals with computers and electronics and stuff. I went there for computer assisted design, but it's a magnet school here in Vegas.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Good question. Okay. So then this is number 57, this eccentric torn odious net. That basically came from the fact that one of my really great friends, his name is John Dacus, he deployed to Afghanistan, and this is his little netbook that he had when he was deployed. And this one, I was playing around with mixing oil and acrylic paints, and that's where all of this blending came from in there. And I also took a lot of this apart and put it back together because I wasn't liking the way that some of this stuff was looking. If you look, you can kind of see where the hot glue was, where I had originally put some pieces and then I didn't like it, and so I moved them. But I don't know. I like leaving the hot glue there because I like seeing where I changed my mind on things.
Yeah.
This is weird. But.
Yeah, it's texture too, which is nice. Yeah. Like, makes it look really rough.
Thank you.
The letters, are they in any kind of order?
No, they're not.
The first thing I asked myself when I saw it.
I've played around with, yeah. No, I've played around with like trying to do different things with keyboard letters. There's a couple sentences you can make that do use all of the different letters just once, but I don't like any of them. They're not meaningful to me, so I don't really want to use them for anything. The first time I mounted that laptop over there to this canvas, I actually did spell out one of those sentences, but I didn't like it because it didn't really connect with me, and I felt like I was just doing the novelty of it, and I didn't want to do it, so I took it off. So, but yeah, this one's interesting. It's just like an abbreviated look at what a laptop kind of looks like. So,
mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I love how the little square is like, it reminds me of like leopard spots almost.
Yeah, a couple of people have said that looks like the leopard print, so from like far away.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That looks like a boat or something because it has that.
Because it has a concave to it.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, so there's that one, and then. This one's number 35, not insincere, cute doctor. This one's like special place in my heart. This one's one of the ones where it's on the flyer. It has a picture of like me taking a picture of the canvas. This one, so I told myself I was not allowed to make any more art until I made my logo, because my logo is really complicated. It has a whole bunch of letters in it, and it took about 2 weeks of graphic design, me sitting there just placing letters where I wanted to place them. So I grounded myself and I'm like, I'm not allowed to make anything else art until I get my logo done. After I completed my logo, this is the first piece I made, and I didn't really notice what I did until after I painted it, but I was looking at it and I'm like, okay, I want it to come out like this. So I put three canvases together so it could come out like this. And then I had neon green paint that I had found on Craigslist, and so I had splattered that on there, and then I added the navy blue and the royal blue, and then after it was all drying, I noticed that it's kind of a reincarnation of my logo, and I didn't even do that on purpose.
Yeah,
so like, yeah, it was just really odd, but I really like the way that this one turned out. This one was a lot of fun to take apart too, because like the little TV tube and all that. Again, this is the one that has the bag on the back of it. If you guys want to look at it, it's kind of nifty, but yeah.
One of my favorite pieces, because I first time I saw it. It looks like the shape of Ohio to me. It's like, I love this thing. It's like, it just makes me feel like I gotta love this. You know? And the tube, it's like the transition from small technology into like now with the iPod screens and the way that it's LED technology. But the tube is just so fascinating as a handheld, simple little thing.
Have you ever taken apart anything big? Big TV or big video?
So. Yeah, a lot of people have offered me the big TVs, unless it's an LCD screen. Like, the only thing that's a little difficult about the big technology is the fact that, like, how am I going to mount that on the canvas? Like, I have a couple printers that I really want to take apart, but I'm trying to figure out how I'm going to mount it. I have also been playing around with, like, building structural things. But even, like, I got a TV that was honestly, like, this big. I got it at a White Elephant party this last December, and I took it apart, and the tube is just so obnoxious. Like, the TV is only this big, but the tube is, like, so big, and it comes out to, like, this back here, and it's really heavy, and I'm just like, how am I going to get this on a canvas? So, yeah, I just have to play around with it. I actually think I'm going to turn that one into a structural piece, but, yeah, that's a good question.
Is there anything about this title or not?
That title is about the person who gave me the Watchmen.
Yeah.
That's, I'm just going to leave it at that. Nice. But yeah. Yeah. So yeah, that one's one of my favorites.
So from three canvases
to no canvas. Yeah. So this one's number 28. This is the first one that I played with not doing a canvas at all. I did still put paint on there because I was still kind of a little weird about just going from doing canvas and paint to not anything at all. But this one actually, all of the wire and everything that's part of this piece, with the exception of this that's holding it up on here, is from the electronic. There's no extra wires. There's a couple extra wood screws just to keep all the pieces together. But other than that, I just used like the wires that were inside of the cord and then the actual cord itself to tie it all together. This one was a lot of fun. This is actually one of my favorite pieces for a long time. I had it hanging out someplace special because I wanted to look at it all the time. But yeah, this one's number 28, eccentric undone risotto. So
I really like the paint.
You do?
Yeah, I like it.
That's good.
It was
good. Good.
I like the purple and the feeling.
Good, I like it.
It's really pretty.
Thank you. But yeah. That was a DVD player. It was just a regular household DVD player that was broken for somebody, so I got it.
Do you paint on the electronics on any other?
No. On that one right there, the camera one, that one I kind of like put some of the stuff on there and then I kind of splattered paint over it. But that's kind of it. So this one's the only one where I actually painted on it. Yes. So. And the next one.
I love the feathers.
Thank you. This one, this one's number 41, stoned out and crack nice. This one's kind of a big deal to me because basically my aunt had recently passed away in September and I had to go out and take care of all of her stuff. I had to clean out her house and everything. And one of the things that she was kind of obsessed with was these solitaire games. And the whole time I was there, I was really upset with her. And so basically the whole time I was just like dying to get back to Vegas so that I could take something apart of hers so I could like digest the situation. And like a couple days before I left, I found this boa in her attic and I knew exactly what I wanted to do with it. So whenever I got off of the plane from Michigan and I got home, I kind of pretty much went straight to making this, and I made it all at the same time, and I didn't have to wait for anything. It just got it out of my system. So it's really simple, and a lot of people have been like, oh, there's not that many pieces, and it's really simple, but I really love this piece. Like, that's one of my favorites.
I think it's great how like, simple and laid out the objects are, because it really brings out the feather boa behind it.
Right.
I don't know if you would notice it as much if it was as chaotic.
Painted, right. Yeah.
It's already contrast in itself, you know.
Yeah.
Hard objects and soft objects.
Right.
Yeah,
I like it.
I enjoy the texture from the feathers behind the glass.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah,
that was one of the things I was playing around with, which was exactly what depth to leave the glass at with the little screws and everything. So I'm glad that you liked it.
You did go.
Thank you. I also kind of dig the shadow on this one, too, because it's weird. But. Yes, what's that one? And then number 29, interconnected or coitus. I hate this piece more than all of my other pieces. I hate it so much. It tormented me. It took me longer than any other piece for me to take apart. And then I mounted like a third to a half of it on that canvas over there. And then I hated it even more. And then it sat in a corner for about a year because I did not want to have to take it apart. And then finally I was like, I'm going to take it apart. So I took it all off. And then I started putting it back on this one. This one, it doesn't look like there's a canvas. There's actually a 12 by 12 canvas on the back that actually had Bruce Lee in it. And basically, I hated that canvas too. So I'm like, I hate this laptop. I hate this canvas. Maybe if I put it together, it'll be a double negative and turn out positive. So I basically just started like layering layers on top of it. And it, if you look at it, it's just really just layer on top of layer on top of layer of laptop.
When I just looked to my right when you were talking about that,
yeah.
So much.
Exactly. So this one, this shadow right here is like the best one because it looks like a monster. Exactly. Right. It's so creepy. I love that shadow. Yeah.
And you said this is the same year as the MacBook?
that was made, this, like, they were made around the same time, so it's like, look at all the pieces that were on this laptop compared to all the pieces that were on that laptop, and that just shows you the difference between, I mean, I'm not trying to sell MacBooks or anything. I mean, I kind of am, because they're good, but I mean, like, I'm just giving you advice. I'm not trying to sell anything, but I mean, like, you could just see the level of craftsmanship, like, all the pieces that you see, with the exception of, like, the buttons or the keys, you know, like, all these little pieces, those were all one piece over there. So it's like you could see right here where there's four pieces for the keyboard keys, there's one piece to make up for that piece, and I like it.
So. I think your frustration shows that it's like this is the most like amorphous piece, you know, that
right.
The complication of it is like it's on display.
Right, yeah, no, this one, super hated it. Still hate it. I hate you. I hate you, number 29. So yeah. So that's.
Is that your least favorite anagram too?
No, that one's actually one of my favorite anagrams because it's interconnected or coitus. So it's like either you're truly connected to somebody or it's just sex. So it's like that was one of the things I was feeling whenever this came. So.
You weren't connected with this piece.
Yeah, I hated this piece. Just it's all about the sex with that piece. That's it. So yeah, that's that one. You can see little Sony. Oh, and then a couple of people have asked me about the batteries, and I was talking to Amanda about this. Honestly, I have opened up pieces and there's been batteries that you wouldn't be able to get to them in normal electronics, and it's kind of just like, why are they there? And I didn't really understand it. I have friends that own a store called The Battery Source, and I kind of talked to them about it. Yeah.
I just went there to buy my charger this week.
Yeah, they're great. And they're geniuses. So like I talked to them about it and they had told me at some point in time that like a lot of the batteries that are inside of electronics are to keep time or to keep the date and they don't actually use that much juice. So as long as they project that you're gonna have that electronic, that's how, you know, those batteries in there. Also, honestly, like I said, this piece was thrown in the corner and like not touched for a while. So, I mean, I'm 95% sure these pieces actually came from it because there are AAA batteries and AA batteries. And I remember putting it on there thinking, like, is this right? And then I realized I think it was. So, yeah, just in case you guys were wondering. But, yeah. Yeah. So, that's that one. So this one is number 37, Two Cinder, One Snot Circuit. The reason why it's named that is because I love this piece just for, like, all the things I get to say about it. So, if you were to look at it from this direction, if you were looking at it from here down, it says Bruce Lee in purple. Like it's like a weird canvas where it says Bruce Lee like that way. This one, what it is it's a digital camera on the outside, and then it's an analog camera on the inside. Because I started this piece by taking this camera apart because I thought there was gonna be weight. This is one of the reasons why I don't do this anymore. But I started it by taking it apart, and as I took it apart and took all the pieces out, I mounted them on the canvas. So I thought that it was gonna be really complicated because it was this big, clunky, like HP digital camera, and I got all the way around the canvas, and then I got to here, and I'm like, oh, that's all the pieces that were in this camera. I've got this whole big empty space. I had actually mounted this on another canvas, which I haven't put anything on yet still, but this one, I hate it on the other canvas, so I'm like, I know what I'm gonna do. I'm just gonna make it separate. So I took some plexiglass that I found and learned how to cut plexiglass on the internet. And then I mounted all of the analog ones. I kind of like the juxtaposition of putting the analog and the circuit and the digital one together. So, but yeah, if you look at it, this is like exactly how I took it all apart. That, so. It's really hard to tell how many pieces are in something until you actually get it apart. So, yeah, there's that one. And then this one right here, I guess we'll do next. And then, so this one is number 55, Dice to Notice Concurrent. This one's a PSP. This was another one that I was playing around with. The pieces, obviously, where I kind of just sectioned it out, but I think this is the last one where I did that, and I think this one turned out the best. Just because I kind of have the little spring in the middle, and yeah, this one was just fun. I only put screws on the top and on the bottom, and there's nothing on the sides, but yeah. This is that one. And then number 54, Circus Once on Rotten Diet. This one also was a friend, my friend that had gone to Afghanistan, came back. So this was the DVD player that he used when he was over there, so that's why it's that name. This one is interesting because it was the first time I really started tearing into battery packs. And basically seeing what was inside of them and how the batteries worked.
Is that dangerous?
Well, I mean, I've zapped myself a couple times on capacitors and things for cameras, but I mean, I'm kind of just used to it at this point, and I've gotten to the point where I don't really zap myself on things anymore. But yeah, I am a little bit more cautious and smoke a little less weed before I do it, but yeah. Yeah, that one was kind of crazy.
I'm glad I didn't bring my children. Yeah. I already took them to see them. You don't need to hear about that one.
Yeah, so that's how that was made. And then,
is that what you consider the top of that one?
This one, it's interesting because, like, well, I mean, a lot of the pieces, you can kind of hang them in any way. And this one, I had it hung on my house the other way, but whenever I brought it up to the gallery, it seemed most appropriate to hang it this way. So there's a lot of...
You had it horizontal?
Yeah, I had it horizontal, but it seemed more appropriate to hang it this way once I got it here. So it's funny because it's like a lot of the pieces that I had them hung differently in my place, and then they were hung... I hung them differently up here, kind of depending on like what was next to it and like where it was and all that, so... And then this one's number 44, Donuts and Tice Correction. Basically, it's a PSP, or not a PSP, it's a PlayStation, I think it's the PlayStation 2, but it's like the weird small one. So I couldn't really find any videos for this on the internet either. Basically, this one was like an odd piece I was playing around with. That's when I was really kind of getting into the shadows because I wanted to put these pieces on the edges of the canvases and see how it would look with these things on the outside of it. So that was the point of kind of making this one. I also like this one because there's a little tiny PSP logo or PlayStation logo in the middle of it. So there's that one.
And then... you talked about the shake test.
Yeah.
Tell, I love what you did because we had talked about how the temperature fluctuates in the gallery. So
yeah.
What did you do to make sure the pieces would be okay?
So, well, basically what I did was I was trying to figure out how to get some of the strings off a while ago. And so I had taken a piece and I had thrown it in the freezer trying to get it to where the strings would freeze and I could just brush all the strings off. But what ended up happening instead was... yeah, all the pieces just fell off because it was in the freezer. So, yeah, that on top of the fact that I figured out whenever I got up here that if I also kind of air it, it kind of also ensures that, you know, all the stuff will stay on there. So, yeah. There's that one. And then there's number 58, So Once Tectonic Intruder. Basically, I named it that because this is kind of what ate up a lot of our time when we were younger. This one was kind of fun because I made this and I put the really thick, heavy acrylic paint on there just in the way that it was sitting on my table at the time. And basically, I had taken apart each one of these pieces and I knew that I wanted a fourth piece and I couldn't find one of these controllers. I don't like buying them, and so I had a friend from Oklahoma send me this controller in time for me to be able to get this together for the show. The other thing that I kind of also dug about this was the fact that whenever I took apart this gun, you can see that there's weights. So there's a weight right here, and then there's a two-part weight that's here and here. And that's what they actually used to make the gun so that it felt right whenever you're shooting it, because I actually, after I saw that, I put it back together and I tried shooting it afterwards, like playing with it, and I'm like, this does feel like significantly different. So that was one of my favorite things about taking that apart. I also played around with the little lens and stuff too, so yeah. What's that one?
I think that's one.
Really?
Yeah.
Awesome.
I like it. I like the whole kind of, you know, everything. Yeah.
Thank you. But yeah, so there's that.
Is this your first gallery show?
Yeah. I did a raw show too, in between like whenever this opened and then tonight, but yeah. Yeah, that was just one night, but this is the first gallery show. So awesome. I'm so happy I did it with Amanda. But yeah, that's that piece. And then, so I think that the last thing that we are gonna kind of talk about was the artist statement. So,
I read this online, I really liked it. Like the bold sides of
it. You liked it?
I love bold sides, yeah.
Really?
Because, you know, I mean, would love for someone to give me such harsh criticism. You know, from right. this point of view, because it's not mine, I
right.
don't know what I'm doing, but yeah. I don't know, I liked your response from such harsh criticism, you know.
Yeah, well, this wasn't in here until tonight. And the reason why this is in here is because, like you said, somehow I got on the radar of some critical correspondence group, and they wrote out a fantastic letter about how much they hated my art, which I was honestly, truly, really excited about whenever I read it. I read it when I was here, and with her. Yeah, so they wrote this whole handwritten thing, and then on top of that, they decided to go on my website and take a look at my artist statement, and it's called. It's an online thing where like they're just anonymous, I guess, and they started doing this. So I did a little research. Apparently, they started their website on March 3rd or 4th, and basically, yeah. So I had to research this. And basically, they started tearing into a couple of the different artists in town, which is...
Oh, so not just you.
Yeah, it's not just me. There's a couple of different artists first, and I didn't think that... Yeah, I didn't think that was second. They posted the letter about my stuff on, was it Wednesday?
Really?
Yeah, it was Wednesday. So... Yeah, so basically, it was kind of just interesting because they really tore into my artist statement, which I kind of thought was messed up, basically because it's my artist statement, and like, yes, I, looking back at my artist statement now, I made this 6 months ago before I even started showing art, before I started doing anything, before I really understood like what I was getting into, and I kind of would like to change it comes off a little militant, which I come off a little militant usually too, but at the same time, I have better words to structure like what my artist statement is now. But I thought it was really, really interesting how much these people tore into this artist statement, because not only did the people from Critical Correspondence do it, but a bunch of people in an additional forum started really getting into it too, and it turned into a whole long thing, and it was actually really fascinating, but then it was all just like people like, you shouldn't do your artist statement like that, and you should do it this way, and here's some articles that you should read about how to write your artist statement. Yeah, and I'm like, this is my statement. Right. Exactly. Yeah.
You're going to pull them out the window of the car and beat them on the
foot. And well, their website's vague too, right? You don't even know what they're about.
Yeah, you don't know what they're about, which is fine. I'm not even that upset about the person. Like, I'm not upset about Critical Correspondence. I'm more upset with the fact that people had the audacity to go online and try and tell me how to write my own artist statement. Because I don't. Exactly. So I didn't really dig that at all. Yeah, so basically, I kind of really thought about this the last 2 days, and I was kind of like comparing it to heresy. Like back in the day, witches would get burned at the stake because they symbolized heresy. And then basically, I looked up this definition for you guys, so let me tell you exactly what the definition is. Heresy is a belief or opinion contrary to orthodox religious doctrine, or an opinion profoundly at odds with what is generally accepted. Cutting capital gains taxes is heresy. So basically, what I decided to do was that I'm going to go ahead and say, fine, you know, like my artist statement, apparently it's really offensive and people don't like it. So I think that what I'm going to do is I'm going to burn my artist statement at the stake. So this is my actual easel. This is what I paint all of my stuff on. So here you go.
Wow. Wow, yeah.
There you go. That's how I feel about it.
Do you
want to
say anything to the people online?
Yeah.
No, you want me to make another statement. Well, this is my statement. That's how I feel about the whole situation. Yeah, like, I don't think that people should be telling me how I'm supposed to be expressing myself. The whole point of being an artist is for you to be able to express yourself the way that you want to express yourself. And if that's how I want to express myself, then I'll do it in fire. That's fine. Yeah, it's still online, so you can look it up online before I change it. But yeah.
Has your opinion of what you're doing and what you're getting into changed since you've opened, since you've been showcasing this?
Honestly, I've had a really positive like feeling about this entire situation. I've gotten nothing but overwhelming like positive feedback, even the negative or the critical feedback I've gotten. I've really enjoyed. I think it's really interesting to hear about it because art is subjective and I see the whole thing as being subjective. It's really interesting because a lot of the pieces that people don't like when I ask them, what are the pieces you like, what are the pieces you don't like? The pieces that people really do like are also the pieces that other people really don't like. And I think that's really interesting. Like, there's honestly, a lot of the pieces I don't generally like, those were kind of honestly the first ones to sell. So like, it's really interesting. I think the whole thing is just fascinating, but
yeah. Well, just from hearing you talk about the work, you attach so many memories and feelings to each piece.
Right. Yeah. I really had a hard time with it. She knows. So, yeah.
Yeah. For those critics to go against something that's so personal to you is kind of alone.
Right. It's and you know what? It's fine. Like, I welcome you to critique my art. I am going to challenge you for you critique my artist statement, but just some of the pretentious, bitchy things that were said in this forum was just like, really? You know, like, is that really what you're going to do with, like, yeah, well, I don't even care, but I mean, like, really, is that how we're going to treat, like, this community? Like, I think that people should be, like, propping each other up instead of, you know, tearing each other down.
I wanted to say it's amazing that you're trying, which that totally comes out wrong.
Right.
I think you're trying. It's cool. This is
you.
A crazy effort and, like, congratulations also because it came out.
Thank you. Fine. So that's it.
Well, so Angie, thank you so much. We've learned a lot, and you are an expert in your craft, and it's just been amazing to listen to you talk about how intimately you know each of the pieces. I mean, each one has its own story, and thank you for sharing that with us.
Yeah, and thank you for listening.
Of course. I did want to let everyone know that we're trying something different for the end of the show. So the pieces on the wall that are still for sale, we've decided to just like greatly discount them and do a bit of a silent auction. So it's going to end tomorrow night at 9, but the prices start at $150 and they go up in $50 increments. So, I mean, when you hear about all the time and effort that Angie put into them, I think you'll recognize the value in that. And we have the prints on the wall. They're just $25 or $50 if you want it with a frame. And over on this wall, the pieces are $50. $50, except for the biggest ones are $100 each. So please stick around, please support Angie, and we're lucky to have the music too. You gotta tell me again your name of your group.
Ironing Board Mafia.
Nice.
Sweet.
Thank you for being here.
And they never are.
Yeah.
Thank you.